nothing. But they were left holding the debt. And because of these huge debts, their country in the long term would not be able to provide them with health care, education, and other social services.
Talk about Congo.
Oh boy, the whole story of Africa and the Congo is such a devastating and sad one, and it's the hidden story, really. We in the United States don't even talk about Africa. We don't think about Africa. You know, Congo has something called coltan, which probably most of your listeners may not have even heard of, but every cell phone and laptop computer has coltan in it. And several million people in the last few years in the Congo have been killed over coltan, because you and I and all of us in the G8 countries demand or at least we want to see our computers inexpensive and our cell phones inexpensive. And of course the companies that make these sell them on that basis, that, oh, here, mine's $200 less than the other company. But in order to do that, these people in the Congo are being enslaved. The miners, the people mining coltan, they're being killed. There's these vast wars going on to provide us with cheap coltan. And I have to say, you know, if we want to live in a safe world, we must be willing, in effect, we must demand that we pay higher prices for things like laptop computers and cell phones, and that a good share of that money go back to the people who are mining the coltan. And that's true of oil, it's true of so many resources, that we are not paying the true cost. And there's millions of people around the world suffering from that. Roughly 50,000 people die every single day from hunger, hunger-related diseases, and curable diseases that they don't get the medicines for, simply because they're part of a system that demands that they put in long hours and get very, very low pay so we can have things cheaper in this country. And Congo is an incredibly potent example of that.
You talk about the so-called defeats in Vietnam and Iraq and what they mean for corporations.
You and I look at them as defeats, perhaps, and certainly anybody who lost a child or a sibling or a spouse in these countries look at them as disasters, as defeats. But the corporations made a huge amount of money off Vietnam, the military industry, huge corporations, the construction companies, and of course they're doing it in a very, very big way in Iraq. So the corporatocracy, the people that are in fact are insisting that our young men and women continue to go to Iraq and fight, they're making a tremendous amount of money. These are not failures to them. They're successes from a very strong economic standpoint. And I know that sounds cynical. I am cynical about these things. I've been there. I've seen it. And, you know, we must learn not to put up with that anymore, all of us.
You were talking to John Perkins. His book is The Secret History of the American Empire. It's the 40th anniversary of the 1967 Israeli-Arab War. You talk about Israel being Fortress America in the Middle East.
I think it's very sad and very telling, once again, that the Israeli people, for the most part, are led to believe that they've been given this land as a payoff, basically, for the Holocaust, because they deserve to be recompensed. And of course, the Holocaust was terrible, and they do deserve to be taken care of and recompensed and have stability. But why would we locate that place in the middle of the Arab world, their traditional enemies? Why would we locate that place in such an unstable area? It's because it is serving as a huge fortress for us in the biggest oil fields known in the world today, and we knew this when Israel was located there. And I think the Israeli people have been terribly exploited in this process. So in fact, we built this vast military base, armed camp, in the middle of the Middle Eastern oil fields that are surrounded by the Arab communities. And in the process, we've obviously created a tremendous amount of resentment and anger and a situation that it's very difficult to see any positive outcome there. But the fact of the matter is, our having this military base in Israel has been a huge defense for us. It's been a place where we could really launch attacks, rely on. It's been our equivalent of the Crusaders' castles in the Middle East. And it's very, very sad. I think it's extremely sad for the Israeli people that they're caught up in all of this. I think it's extremely sad for the American people. It's extremely sad for the world that this is going on.
As we crisscross the globe, John Perkins, which is exactly what you did in your years as an international consultant, having been groomed by the National Security Agency, but then being a coming top economist in an international consulting firm, you have also written books about shamanism. You also write about Tibet. Where does Tibet fit into this picture?
Well, you know, I was just in Tibet a couple of years ago, and it was an interesting thing because I took a group of about 30 people into Tibet with me as part of a nonprofit organization. I was leading the trip, and some of these people had been in the Amazon with me, been to other places. And of course, Tibet right now it's very depressing because the Chinese presence is extremely strong, and you see how the Tibetan culture has been put down, and you're always aware that there's Chinese soldiers and spies all around you. And many of the people on the trip came to the realization, yeah, this is terrible here. Free Tibet, we all know about that, but the ones who'd been with me on trip to the Amazon were the oil companies and our own military doing the same thing, said, but doesn't this remind us of what we're doing in so much of the world? And it's something we tend to forget. We can all wave banners about free Tibet, which we should, but how about freeing the countries that are under our thumb too? And certainly Tibet is not nearly, I hate to say it this way because some people might disagree with me, but I think Iraq is in worse shape than Tibet is these days, although both of them are in pretty bad shape. But so what we saw in Tibet is that same kind of model that we're implementing around the world, and yet most Americans are not aware that we're doing it. They're aware that the Chinese are doing it, but they're not aware that we're doing it on actually a much bigger level than the Chinese are.
John Perkins, talk about your transformation. You were making a lot of money. You were traveling the world. You were in a position where you were meeting presidents and prime ministers of countries, bringing them to their knees. What made you change, and then ultimately the decision to write about it?
You know, Amy, when I first got started, I grew up with 300-400 years of Yankee Calvinists in New Hampshire and Vermont with very strong moral principles, came from a pretty conservative Republican family, all during the 10 years that I was an economic hitman from 71 to 81, I was pretty young, but it bothered my conscience, and yet everybody was telling me I was doing the right thing, like you said, presidents of countries, the president of the World Bank, Robert McNamara, patted me on the back, and I was asked to lecture at Harvard and many other places about what I was doing, and what I was doing was not illegal. Should be, but it isn't. And yet in my heart, it always tore at my conscience. I'd been a Peace Corps volunteer, I saw, and as time went by and I began to understand more and more, it got to be more and more difficult for me to continue doing this. Had a staff of about 4 dozen people working for me. Things were building up. And then one day I was on vacation sailing in the Virgin Islands, and I anchored my little boat in off of St. John Island, and I took the dinghy in and I climbed this mountain on St. John Island in the Virgin Islands up to this old sugarcane plantation in ruins. And it was beautiful. Bougainvillea, the sun was setting. I sat there and felt very peaceful, and then suddenly I realized that this plantation had been built on the bones of thousands of slaves. And then I realized that the whole hemisphere had been built on the bones of millions of slaves. And I got very angry and sad. And then it suddenly struck me that I was continuing that same process, and that I was a slaver, that I was making the same thing happen in a slightly, in a different way, more subtle way, but just as bad in terms of its outcome. And at that point, I made the decision I would never do it again. And I went back to Boston a couple of days later and quit.
We're talking to John Perkins, worked for Chaz Maine International Consulting Firm, self-described economic hitman, now has written a new book called The Secret History of the American Empire. When we come back from break, we'll talk about, well, from quitting the American Empire to taking it on. Stay with us.
In life for free, but you can give them to the birds and bees. I want money.